This was about the 18th of March, 1912. 2 days later, fellow worker Resick and the 27 men arrived by boat from Los Angeles. And after resting for a day, we started to sell the papers on the streets. We divided up in threes, two going ahead selling papers, while one stayed behind to watch the action of the police and vigilantes. We had sold quite a few papers before they bothered us. Then they commenced taking the papers away from the boys, arresting some and turning them loose. So we soon ran out of papers. They then confiscated the San Diego Herald and the San Francisco Bulletin and would not allow us to sell any papers that gave a fair report of the fight. The next day, being the 22nd of March at 2 o'clock p.m., 13 of us went out to the corner of 6th and E Streets to hold a meeting. We started singing a song entitled Casey Jones, the Scab Engineer. We were immediately surrounded by plainclothes men, some of them police and some vigilantes. They arrested the 13 of us and marched us to the police station.
Oh, life under our present system is not so great a thing that he who has an ideal and loves liberty should not be willing to part with it. But life in San Diego is worse than death. I cannot believe that the number of intelligent people in the United States is so small, that they could not bring moral pressure upon this city to stop its atrocities. It was the intelligent minority which forced the Southern planner to stop his murderous treatment of the black man. Surely the same can be done today. It is with that in view that this article is written, and not in complaint of anything we have endured. It is also because I feel that the crimes, the savagery, and the unspeakable cruelties perpetrated by the San Diego thugs, with the connivance of the police and the support of the San Diego Union and Tribune, must be brought to an end. Crime begets crime, and violence inevitably gives birth to violence. If San Diego is justified in violence, why not its victims? To avoid both, I appeal to all fair-minded and liberty-loving people throughout the country to join in a determined campaign against San Diego and its horrors. Emma Goldman.
We lived that night on a freight. This was April 3rd. We were all in a boxcar. The crowd cheered us as we left Santa Ana. The boys were in good humor and singing. I told them to be on the alert for something was sure to happen, because she was not making a stop at Capistrano, but was going right on. My suspicions were soon realized, for all at once she came to a stop, and the drunken mob of vigilantes came up on both sides of the car with a gun in one hand and a club in the other, and on both sides of the track, a gunman with rifles. They proceeded to club us off the car. There was no use resisting, as we had nothing to defend ourselves with, although I felt like taking my chances. After we got on the ground, we were made to hold up our hands while they were going through us. I was lucky to have committee money, something like $38 besides $2 of my own money, wrapped around my leg. We were kept holding our hands up for an hour, if not more. I was clubbed several times for letting my hands down, being tired. Clubbing became general when we were too exhausted to hold our hands up any longer. They then herded us into a cattle pen, made us lay down on the ground, or rather manure pile. We were all bruised by this time. One fellow laying next to me had a couple of ribs broken. Some were so bruised as to be uncomfortable to lay down, seeking relief by sitting up. We were punished further by clubbing and the usual expression, "You son of a bitch, kill him." The whiskey was arousing their spirits wonderfully. In the morning, we were told to get up. We were wondering what was in store for us, but we were soon to find out. We were taken out of groups of five to be made to run the gauntlet as we were taken out in fives. Another bunch were coming in from San Diego. Their looks told us the clubbing. Some could hardly walk, but their faces were determined. As the bunches of fire were taken out in the, and up the track to run the gauntlet, my experience, and as I saw them run the gauntlet, the first thing on the program was to kiss the flag. You son of a bitch, come and kiss it, goddamn ya. As he said it, I was hit with a wagon spoke all over. When you get kissed the flag, you were told to run the gauntlet. 50 men being on each side, each man being armed with a gun and a club and some had long whips. When I started to run at the gauntlet, the men were ready for action. They were in high spirits from booze. I got about 30 feet when I suddenly was struck across the knee. I felt the wagon spokes sink in, splitting my knee. I reeled over. As I did, I felt the club being withdrawn with some effort. I fell on the side of the track. Two of the vigilantes came up to me, pointing their guns at me, saying, "Get up, you son of a bitch." The pain was intense. "You broke my knee, you might as well kill me," I said. He lifted the club and was about to strike when an onlooker grabbed him and said, "You let him alone, you coward, or I'll kill you." I told him my knee was broken. He felt it and buried his hand in between my kneecap. As I was laying there, I saw other fellow workers running the gauntlet. Some were bleeding freely from cracked heads. Others were knocked down to be made to get up and run again. Some tried to break the line, only to be beaten back. It was the most cowardly and inhuman cracking of heads I ever witnessed.
There are only a few words that I care to say, and this court will not mistake them for a legal argument, for I am not acquainted with the phraseology of the bar, nor the language common to the courtroom. There are two points that I want to touch upon, the indictment itself and the misstatement of the prosecuting attorney. The indictment reads, "The people of the state of California against J.W. Wright and others." Well, it's a hideous lie. The people in this courtroom know that it's a lie. The court itself knows that it's a lie, and I know that it's a lie. If the people of the state are to blame for this persecution, then the people are to blame for the murder of Michael Hoy and the assassination of Joseph Miguel Lasik. They are to blame and responsible for every bruise, every insult, and every injury inflicted upon the members of the working class by the vigilantes of this city. The people deny it, and have so emphatically denied it, that Governor Johnson sent Harris Weinstein down here to make an investigation and clear the reputation of the people of the state of California from the odor that you would attach to it. You cowards throw the blame upon the people, but I know who is to blame, and I name them. It is Spreckles and his partners in business, and this court is just a lackey and lickspittle of that class, defending the property of that class against the advancing horde of starving American workers. The prosecuting attorney, in his plea to the jury, accused me of saying on a public platform at a public meeting, "To hell with the courts, we know what justice is." He told a great truth when he lied, for if he had searched the innermost recesses of my mind, he could have found that thought, never expressed by me before, but which I express now. To hell with the courts. I know what justice is, for I have sat in your courtroom day after day and have seen members of my class pass before this so-called bar of justice. I have seen you, Judge Sloan, and others of your kind send them to prison because they dared to infringe upon the sacred rights of property. You have become blind and deaf to the rights of man to pursue life and happiness, and you have crushed those rights so that the sacred right of property shall be preserved. Then you tell me to respect the law? I do not. I did violate the law, as I will violate every one of your laws, and still come before you and say, to hell with the courts, because I know, I believe that my right to life is far more sacred than the sacred right of property that you and your kind so ably defend. I do not tell you this in the expectation of getting justice, but to show my contempt for the whole machinery of law and justice as represented by this and every other court. The prosecutor lied, but I will accept his lie as a truth and say again so that you, Judge Sloan, may not be mistaken as to my attitude. To hell with your courts. I know what justice is.
I am Laura Payne Emerson. I am Laura Emerson Payne. It is April 5th, 1912, I am standing beside the bier of our fallen martyr, Michael Hoey, and delivering his sad eulogy to you, his friends. Fellow workers, I count it an honor to be accorded the privilege of paying tribute on this occasion to our martyred dear fellow worker, Michael Hoey. He was a soldier in the war for industrial freedom. Early in life, he joined the forces that were making for better conditions for his class, the working class, and to the day when he fell mortally wounded and was carried from the field of battle, never, never did he falter. It was in San Diego. A fight for free speech was on. An infamous ordinance had been passed by the city council denying the natural and constitutional right of free speech and public assembly to certain citizens. Many brave souls had undertaken to test the odious law by attempting to speak on the streets and had met with the policeman's club and the jail. Among those on the firing line in that contest was Michael Hoey at 63 years of age. When told he was too old to enlist in such a fight, and he should leave it to younger and more vigorous men, he replied, "I have nothing to give but myself, and life is not worth living when all liberty is gone." That night, amid a cheering crowd, his fine face appeared just for a moment. His voice was raised in a last appeal to his class to stand firm for human rights. Then burly guardians of the law snatched him down with kicks and clubs, and jail and starvation silenced his voice forever. Shall we say forever? Can it be that such souls die? If it be true that the sea of oblivion engulfs those who leave this shore and their voices are hushed in everlasting night, then Michael Hoey is dead. But from his ashes will spring 10,000 soldiers of freedom more powerful than he. And the message upon his dying lips will be carried by millions of voices shouted from the housetops and the mountains of the world. Our fellow worker was a hero in the strife. The army with which he marched was not mounted, booted, nor spurred. Neither do they carry arms. But from Maine to California, their campfires are burning. And from ocean to ocean, their world over, their banners float. What army is this? The Grand Army of Organized Labor. Michael Hoey belonged to that army, entrenched, and its recruits fast mustered wherever wage slaves bear beneath their burdens, wherever capitalism has laid its withering hand, the hope to win peacefully. But if that be not possible, they will win. They must. And today, standing beside this bier of our fellow worker, martyr in the world's greatest revolution, we solemnly swear to carry on the battle with renewed energy, and to never stop until we avenge his death and achieve victory in the cause for which he died. And now, friend, fellow worker, we leave you to rest. Far from friends and relatives of other days, we are now your friends. Today, after your long, laborious life, you repose beneath a coverlet of flowers, your weary body oft neglected in life, tenderly cared for in death. Such is the irony of fate. You, who no doubt, as others of your class, oft driven from place to place with no shelter, nowhere to lay your head, now find a place of abode where hunger shall not overtake you, where no policeman's club will bruise you, nor gruff voice bid you move on. You have fought your fight. You have finished your work. Although a private in the ranks, you wear a laurel upon your brow. You have given your all. A Christ could do no better. An injury to one is an injury to all. We shall not forget. Thank you.